go 1,000 miles away, and the game continues. It's like a game. And they continue this satanic game on you. And then, of course, it has other levels, too, of, you know, there's always the, you know, what people report, like the electronic harassment and all that. That came a little bit later. But before that, you have witchcraft harassment, you know, these coincidences that couldn't possibly be. The coordination of people, like you say, that don't know each other, that are coming at you, saying things that only you would know in the background, like 2 aisles away in the bookstore. And they're talking about you when you happen to be passing by looking for a book. And then you stop and you realize, I don't know who they are. And they just look like they're just random customers. And they're talking about me and they're mocking me. They're saying things that only I know. And they're laughing and making noises, and then they're making insults at the same time, knowing that I'm hearing them, and then hiding behind a couple different bookshelves. And then I turn the corner to see them and, you know, and try to confront the situation, look at what's going on. And it's all like, they never said that. They never did that. They don't know what you're talking about. They have no idea what you mean, as if they didn't do it, but something else did it. But it was them. And, you know, they do know what they're doing.
In our chat room, Omar's in the chat room, and he's talking about what you were talking about. Somebody was asking, what are you talking about? He says, the pressure is coming from the collective hive mind societies that have natural telepathic and kinetic energy abilities that allow them to interface real-time live. And maybe that's the technical explanation for it. You know, I'm using the generic term of
hive mind,
evil,
yeah.
Spirituality,
yeah,
you know.
But it's also multidimensional in the sense of time and space is also violated, too. Like, okay, that, let's say that bookstore, let's call it a bookstore in, you know, San Fernando Valley somewhere, you know, just because it's happened to me there. And then, you know, the whole place is seething with these, you know, people as demons, and you got to get out of there. You go back the next day, everything is normal. The same people are just nice as can be. Nothing happened. What are you talking about? You try to tell people about what's really going on. They say, hey, what's going on? Tisk, tisk, because they know. You know, they know they're doing it to you. And when you explain it, they go, well, that sounds terrible. Tell me more. Well, there's these people and they're following me and they're doing things to me and they're listening to my phone conversations and they're talking to me through the speakers, through the television, and all this stuff is going on. And that sounds like you might need some therapy. You need to go back and see the doctor. You need, you know, medication. You sound psychotic. Okay. All of that they coordinate and they do to people to make, and then, you know, they, of course, they send you to the psychiatrist or somebody like that, who, by the way, is one of them who's in on it. And so the whole thing becomes this sort of cluster F, you know, and they say, look, you know, then they'll take you aside, like taking you off stage and say, look, this is like a play that's going on. You know, look, you don't have a chance. Okay. There is no way you can beat this thing. You have no chance of survival. You have no chance of success. You have the only option you have is to, you know, join us, be our slave, whatever. And maybe one day after a few years, if you make the right moves, you'll be able to breathe. But until then, you're screwed, buddy. And we don't care about you. We enjoy driving you off the cliff because you know what? Every time one of you bites the dust, ka-ching, we get another leg up. We get another piece of power. And we got everybody, all the lambs, we got them all separated so they don't know who each other is. Oh, that was back in those days. All the lambs, nobody knows who each other is. Nobody knows. We don't know that we're like friends, you and me. You know, we don't know. I don't know that you're a friend. Everyone is potentially the enemy because they kept us. You know, remember that song, Keep Them Separated, from a few decades ago? Well, everyone has to be separated, and they keep everyone separated. And then when there's a problem, they go, they'll say, well, tell me, you look a little stressed. Is everything all right? And like they're your friend.
Yeah,
and then or the shrink or somebody else that's in a counseling position is everything. You know, tell me what's been going on in the heat. How do you feel about that? And you know you sound psychotic. You know, of course, there's no way that these people are coordinating against you. That just sounds paranoid. Mm. And that's where that goes for kids. Because kids, if they're under 18, they really don't have, they can't stop their parents from putting them into, at least a 24 or 72-hour hold. And then, you know, they start writing stuff up on you. And if you look like you can't play ball, like there's no hope in getting you, then they start the discrediting process. Ah, yes. And by the way, they do this to everybody from the highest high to people that are just, average everyday people. I mean, there's nobody exempt from this. Nobody. Everyone that's got a soul is equal in being targeted. And, you know, they start in ruining, your reputation, and they, make sure you're not viable employment-wise, and that, if you go to the doctor, they're going to do something to ruin your health. And if you try to look for any help at all, they're going to, so you're basically trying to go under the radar, trying to survive. And then if it's really bad, really bad, sometimes, people who live in cities, especially, you'll have cars going by. I mean, we had vans going by, and we had 24-hour surveillance. We had infrared from the guy across the street who was in the CIA, and we had cameras on us. So if we went somewhere, they watch us on like their own closed network. And you could drive anywhere you want, and they're just watching you. And then they insert themselves. Then they try to, they go into your house when you're gone, and they move stuff around. And they just, it's such a nightmare, and so evil, and so mean, so you're the only one that cares whether you live or not. They don't, and you're the only one that cares whether you have pain. They don't. And every one of them says, oh, let me try to help you, or let me be your girlfriend, or let me, and then they report back, and so they keep, it even gets so elaborate that they set up wives and children and houses and jobs even that are all artificial, just like the, I know I sound crazy right now. I don't mean to sound crazy, but I'm sorry. It's, I am not a crazy person. And I don't talk about this that often because it just sounds nuts, but I promise you it's going on. I promise that everything I've said is true, even understated somewhat.
No, I think, a lot of people in that so-called flyover country don't experience a lot of this stuff because they're not quote important. But on the other hand, there's also small little groups of satanic groups and whatnot that appear in the...
I got it in Topeka, Kansas.
Yeah. So...
Okay. Average people doing the same thing. And they're just people that, like, work at the diner or, just average working class people doing the same thing in Kansas. So there's no way out of it. And like I said, I went to Hawaii that one time, and there was get to the bar, waiting for a table at this one kind of lousy restaurant, and the guy goes, "We know who you are." Just bums my whole day out, triggers me, and ruins my whole dinner. And then there was somebody taking pictures at random in the hotel. It wasn't the best hotel room. You know what I mean? It happens. I know people who are just like barely, without their employment, people that are even on welfare, people that are homeless. You want to know something? I met all these homeless people in LA that the reason they're homeless is because of this problem. They became homeless on purpose to try to escape it. But guess what happened? That all the people that are dealing with them, and because they have to eat, and sometimes they put on a dinner or a missionary, have a little mission to the homeless and stuff. All these people are all involved in it too. And So the homeless guy is out in the ditch behind the market in Topanga Canyon or wherever he is. He's complaining to me because I get a lot of these people to talk to me. They will talk to me. They'll tell me what's going on. And, I just was riding my motorcycle around. And, at one point I was riding my motorcycle around talking to the homeless, and I'd get them water and different things. And I'd say, you know, what's your story? What's going on? And they know everything. They know everything that's going on. And all of them will admit that this is happening.
Let me ask you, this has popped up in the chat room in YouTube. If you're watching, by the way, on YouTube Live, you can, you know, the chat room should be right there. You can get involved. But the, and there's also a chat room in Spreaker. But the question of clones came up, and it's something that I've always had a problem with, because being a science guy, you know, science and math was my thing. When I look into cloning, I mean, the cloned person or thing has to grow up. It takes 20 years to get to be 20 years old, right? Mm-hmm. So when they talk about cloning people and all of a sudden they're exchanging the clones for the real people and all that, I just, you know, and then they say, well, you know, they're way more advanced. But I just can't stomach by that. I mean, is it possible? Yeah, anything's possible. But what do you think about that?
I looked into it a little bit. I'm not really an expert in that field, but of course I know that super advanced technology is possible, and I know that what I know about these clones is that, you know, people can grow them up in a short period of time.
I don't know that.
It's so exotic. I mean, come on, it's like the UFOs. Okay. We had experiences with UFOs that, Trish, my wife and me, had to fight them. They were following us. There was a problem we had. And then one of these little alien guys showed up in our room, you know, and scared me to my core. And that triggered a memory of satanic abuse that I had covered up. And it was a weird whole journey involving this Indian mystic guy, all kinds of weird people that we, you know, happened then. But we fought them. And after coming to the Lord, you know, it's after we gave our lives totally to Jesus Christ, guess what? We really didn't deal with that oppression from the, you know, people in outer space or wherever they're from coming at us. But this little being that showed up in the house, the head was about where the doorknob is, right? And the eyes were like, there's a light moving behind the eyes, like back and forth like this, like that, you know? And the look, whatever, it could look, drill right through me. It was terrible, like what a lot of people report. And but the event had to do with something in my own life. Very strange. And, you know, the Lord protected me. I mean, you know, I didn't get involved in chasing around the UFOs. I mean, we'd go to a MUFON meeting or two in Los Angeles trying to find out, you know, what the hell's going on. And our eyes were really open to another level. It's back about 1992, 1993, when we heard the testimony of somebody that had been ritually abused in a church and then abducted by the UFOs, and the military was involved in it too. And they used her, they programmed her to basically abduct children to be used, obviously, in rituals, but, you know, being picked up by these UFOs. And it was all tied in with the military-industrial complex, the ritual abuse of children, some churches, basements in churches, and even right out in the main area of a church. And they all seem to be tied in together. And when she was talking, and her, you know, it was kind of like Mark Phillips and what's her name, the survivor, Kathy O'Brien, that her handler, not handler, but deprogrammer guy was there. And she was talking and trying very desperately to get this word out, which sounded completely nuts, really completely crazy. But here's what happened in the audience. It was filled with people, maybe 1,000 people were there at the in Burbank. And remember that woman next to us, she just leaps out of the chair and starts screaming. And people are getting triggered right and left from this woman and screaming, I thought this was about UFOs. I want to talk about UFOs. I don't want to talk about this. You know, obviously they're, in, you know, victims too. Mm-hmm. And yet they suppressed it all. And then what do you do with it? You know, they talk about abduction, you know, you go, you know, coast to coast to AM, they have, you know, it's like a sort of a bipolar view of it, where you have either it's demonic in the Christian view, or it's, you know, the New Age kind of view of their, you know, the Intergalactic Federation, Star Wars, it's our brethren from outer space, whatever. Yeah. And nobody ever gets to this really not nasty, dirty, gritty, awful connection of okay, the UFOs are child abusers, pedophiles, ritual killers, child rapists. What the hell is going on here? And of course, there is a big sex part of it, but then, you know, it'd be sex with demons in my view. And I don't know. It seems like when we came to the Lord, when we finally gave our lives, because we always were spiritual people, but when we finally gave our lives to the Lord, all that horrible, horrible oppression from that reality stopped. Mm. And we live in New Mexico, you know, as you know, and you know, I'm looking right now down toward Sandia Mountain. I think people know what I mean. And the lab's right down there. Los Alamos is right up here. And we're living out in the wilderness, out in the country here. And guess what? If you're really into this UFO thing, you should be able to come out here, sit on the porch, and just stare at the sky. Yeah, there are things moving around up there sometimes. I don't care. I don't need it. I don't want it. So I shut the book on that.
I only had two instances. I'll only mention one, though, where I did a show on Feet to the Fire about tall whites. And I forgot the lady who was on talking about it. She talked about Love Bites was her book, and I can't think of her name right now. And I was on the road driving, but I got home, and I had to get up early in the morning, so I just slept in the truck locally, right? So I woke up, and I was yelling out loud, like, no, like that. I woke up, and I saw in my truck, the truck I had was tall inside, one of what they call them, condos. There was a tall white, by definition, and it just dissolved. And I was sitting there going, did I? Because, you know, when you wake up, you can kind of, you're kind of dreaming. Maybe you made it up with the shadows, you know, and all this stuff. But I had a headache inside my head. Literally, you can feel it inside my head. And I was sick to my stomach for a good portion of the day. Well, it happened again. The same thing, right? And I woke up the same way. No, only this time I woke up and I went, no, you have no authority over me. I'm calling upon Jesus Christ. And if that's not good enough for you, Michael, and Jesus Christ, if my word is enough, you have no authority. This is what I'm yelling. Right? I'm coming out of it.
Yeah? I know.
And I had the same headache, and I had the same nauseous, but it never happened again.
That very similar to my experience, the same thing. We rebuked these things. We rebuked all of it and sent them away. And, you know, it's a demonic oppression. And what do? Well, they come back. You know, people have demons. Well, they come back. And like you were saying, the pressure within the hive mind coming at you, some days are just awful with, you know, quit, stop, you suck, kill yourself, you're really this, you're really that, you know, you've, whatever, you know, the litany of horrible things that are in your head. And then a lot of times what I'll do in a situation like that is I know that's spiritual warfare, and I'll rebuke that spirit in the name of Jesus Christ. I'll put the blood of Jesus on the situation, and I'll just say, you know, I will cast it out, and I will return hopefully back to sleep. But it's a struggle because, see, what you do and what we do, and by proclaiming Jesus, because that's the most powerful name there is, that's the most egregious thing you can do on this planet now that, you know, that's in Satan's grip temporarily. It's full-out war on you. It's full-out war on me. And if you're making any progress here with your show and getting people to open their eyes and you're doing good work— you will be, you know, they will come after you in the spiritual realm, and that you may not see them. And it could be something like, you know, you could be, just have some series of unfortunate things happen too. You know, and like you were talking about illness and all that, that's all part of that spiritual battle. Mm. So we just have to be really, really fervent prayer warriors all the time. And, like I pray the blood of Jesus on this podcast, on this broadcast, on all of this, and on all the listeners and all the people watching. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Pray the blood of Jesus, because that's what it, you know, you've got to constantly be doing that for each other. It's going good, though. We're having a good time.
The thing about when I had this interview with this lady is, like, I never heard of tall whites. Because, you know, I'm not into the UFO thing, but at doing the show, I'm open to all stuff. Like Art Bell. I mean, I came from the Art Bell camp, right? So maybe she's familiar with them. She wrote a book about love bites, about how they interact, whatever. So maybe they went, who's this guy? You know, and so they, because they're not omnipresent, they're not omnipowerful. They have their, they acquire information and they go, oh, let's check this out, whatever, you know. But I do know that for, you know, people who are not intimate Christians, they will comment and say, you know, it's funny, of all the religions of the world, why do the the negative side come after Christianity. They don't come after Scientology. They don't come after the Mormons, per se. I mean, I only know a few of them. But they come after Christianity, and the people aren't necessarily any kind of great people. They're just regular people who love Jesus, right? So yeah. Why is it? And I'm thinking that because Jesus had won this when he was on earth. He won this little thing and has been given power over these principalities and so on. So, of course, anybody who is looking toward that is going to be a danger, because a Buddhist isn't going to go out and change the world. You know, and I'm not even criticizing Buddhism or not. I'm just saying that there seems to be this military side of God who's fighting evil seems to be through the line of Jesus.
I tried to be a Buddhist for a while. And you know what I got tired of? I got tired of people telling me that my karma was my fault.
Yeah.
You know? And it's I'm like, so I get hit by a truck. It's all my fault. Everything that happens, and bad stuff would happen. And they would just keep saying, you need to look within to find the answer. Yeah. You need to be more loving. You need to be more this. You need to be more that. I got so frustrated with the damn thing. I said, you know, this isn't going anywhere. You people are just all deluded. And I just walked out. And I tried, you know, the whole yoga, Siddha yoga, and I tried all these different things. But all of them came back to this, you know, you're responsible for your karma kind of thing. You know, this sort of works-based, salvational, you need to really earn your way into, you know, nirvana, moksha, whatever these different states of being are that they want. And with Jesus, the Lord sets us free instantaneously.
Yeah, I'm not saying that I haven't caused some of my own problems. You know, I mean, you can go the other way, where it's all the devil's fault, you know, and I'm going like, well, it's a teamwork, you know. So I try to find out what I'm doing to help screw things up and take steps to do what I can. But for my own personality, I had to learn to not take responsibility for everything, because I was actively taking responsibility for everything, other people. So I kind of had to walk it back. Some people got to walk it forward. It's everybody else's fault, you know, and they need to step up. I needed to step back a little bit personally.
You're a typical lamb, you know. I mean, the lambs are always taking the blame for everything, and they have to learn not to,
right.
You know, because the world wants to foist all that onto the, you know, their evil deeds onto, you know, people that, you know, if you're lamb, meaning you're not in the world system, you're not a Babylonian, you're not a Satanist, you're not one of so many different ways into this world system. And so you're the bad guy. So they want to foist all the, so then eventually you go, oh, I'm sorry, that must be my fault. I used to, my daughter, she got so mad at me because I just kept saying, I'm sorry. I kept apologizing for everything. And I didn't even know why I was doing it. And then she said, every time you say, I'm sorry, I'm going to hit you in the arm. Hit me right there in the arm. And it hurt after a while, after about four or five hits, right in the same place. I'm like, you know, okay, all right, you know. And so that was, did I learn from that?
I think I did.
And I started realizing that, you know, I still get that oppression. It comes as oppression within. And you know, you feel in the pit of your stomach, the sinking feeling.
Yeah.
And then you start feeling guilty. And you start feeling like, well, you're ashamed of yourself for whatever. It's just general. It's not anything specific. It just starts mounting up and mounting up. And that's the enemy, James. That's the everyone I know. And I know quite a few lambs, if you will, and they all go through a very, very similar thing. It's just something we have to keep in mind, that the Lord will deliver us from that. But we have a tendency to take it on ourselves, to take it on our shoulders, to blame ourselves, or to be ashamed that we didn't do more, or we should have done. And when you're following the Lord, you can't put yourself on a measuring stick like that. If you're sold out to the Lord and doing the things He wants, He might have you just standing on the corner and producing nothing, you know, because He needs you there. And you go, well, what did you do today? Well, I stood on the corner because I thought the Lord wanted me to.
Well, you're available. You're available, and your talents are known. And if you're available, say you're on that corner, use that scenario. Well, that person who you may have helped made a different choice that day. So, you know, but someone else could have made another choice, you know. So I kind of just go along with it. Let me, you know, if I can, this is good stuff, and I don't mean to cut this, but I'd like to talk a little bit about QAnon. Now, you've been very vocal on your podcast, and anybody who's listened to you, you know, but I agree with you. I mean, early on, when I first started reading QAnon stuff, red flags were up all over the place because I learned about the art of BS from listening back to Art Bell days and dealing with the Planet X people, the Zetas.
I remember that, yeah.
Dealing with David Booth and Social Fall and going Social forward Fall with who's that guy from the Enterprise Project? Mars, the Face on Mars guy.
Oh gosh. Richard Hoagland.
Hoagland, yeah. All these people have something in common. They talk to you in questions. Well, what do you think this is? And that, it's all a way of con artists to get you to fill in the blank. I mean, when you get a psychic reading, right? I think there are people who have psychic gifts, or whether it be dynamic or spiritual, but we'll take the con artist. They're going to say, well, I'm getting an M. I'm getting an M. And you say, Mary? I got a sister Mary. Yeah, okay. You know, they're just feeling you out, right? So I'm reading this QAnon stuff from day one. I'm going like, this is all crap. Because if he was really somebody on the inside, he comes out and he just says it. What's the stuff about a Bible when it talks about a prophet? If they say something and it doesn't come through, fear them not, whatever. So if somebody's got inside information and they're saying this is what's happening and it isn't, they're done.
They're not insiders.
Yeah, they're just coming up, you know, and you call this, when you call them on the carpet, Alex Jones and that, when they started doing the Z-Anon, I call them, you know, with that Zach guy. So what happens now? Newsweek has a big spread, right? Crucifying painful. Alex Jones for the QAnon stuff. So he walks into the ratings. Hey, there's a lot of people following this. Let's do this. And so now instead of talking about his alleged talks about Sandy Hook, now they can go into the QAnon thing. And it's like, see, that's what you get.
So, see, you know what? There's a lesson here. And I pray for Alex all the time, you know. But I saw this thing happening, I mean, you know, back at Mandalay when the Q thing popped up. And that's about when you started, you and I both started down this road about the same time. I remember you were saying, I went into I was on a 4chan. I asked wherever you were, you asked a question and they all jumped on you.
Yeah.
That's like a sure sign of a cult or some kind of weird, right there, that's another red flag. But what happened with the Alex Jones and Zach and all that was, I remember the day it happened, and I heard the broadcast. He said, Zach is the real QAnon, and he only gets, we get 40,000 views, and then Q gets over a million. It's just like, it's not fair. The next thing you know, and he's lusting after that traffic. You can see, he's one thing. He's kind of an open book. You can see it.
Yeah.
And then the next thing you know, all of InfoWars, every channel, every person has adopted QAnon.
Corsi, that was disappointing.
And then Zach goes, QAnon is holding up the pillars of our republic. And I'm part of the QAnon team, too, almost alluding to it. He didn't really say it straight out. But
right.
And then ever since then, now here's the lesson. Now there's a spiritual lesson here. And that is, you know, obviously about money versus the truth. You know, buy the truth and sell it not, which is a biblical principle. And don't covet what the other guy has. You know what I mean? It's like let if QAnon, some phenom on the internet gets, you know, suddenly becomes popular, gets some views. It doesn't mean that Alex Jones has to run over there to horn in on some of that traffic because maybe it shouldn't be always about money with him, right? So. You know, this whole thing, in my view, backfired. But back to QAnon for a second. Even before the book of Q, he promised that Trump was like this Superman guy behind the scenes, rounding up all the bad guys, John Podestas and Obamas and all these bad people have done these awful things and the pedophiles, and it's going to be a nice world for us. Now, what people missed, and this is really key to the whole thing, to understanding the whole thing, that the entire Q operation came from the New Age, came from Nasera, Sananda, which is like the New Age Jesus, the global reset, everyone's going to get free money, the reawakening of the ancient memory, the rejuvenation of people, the letting out of prison, that the planet will be let out of this prison away from all these reptiles that are holding us down and keeping us in bondage, and, you know, all the things the New Agers talk about. And then we had the symbolism of the white rabbit, the hole, the Q hole, and then all the, you know, the asking these stupid questions, and then people reading into it and, you know, getting caught up in the game. It's a game that Q was playing. It's a game with people. He played everybody. And then I had people that were so into the cult. I said, well, all these things didn't happen. Podesta's walking around. Hillary's walking around. All this, you know, this invasion of the CIA building. It wasn't a Q thing, but it was like around that time. You know, all this stuff didn't happen. And when I tell somebody, they go, yes, it did. Q is 100% accurate. It's just like the Heaven's Gate cult. You know what I mean? Jonestown. It's on that level.
Yeah.
And now I know we have a real problem. Now I know we have a real, real problem. And because a lot of good Christian people that I know that, you know, that I'm friends with got kind of going down that rabbit hole, and I know, and I don't blame them. I know what happened. There's a very powerful spirit in this new age. It's the Luciferian spirit. It's very powerful. And people get hypnotized by it. And they don't know what they're doing. They you know, you, and they'll kill you. I mean, you know, to defend their, because they think they're on the verge of getting, you know, the world's going to be at peace. So we're on the verge of this beautiful world. Don't take it away from me. Don't take it away from me. My hope. And they'll kill you for it. And I saw that very thing going on. And I knew it was wrong. I knew that, I know there's no easy way out of this life. I know there's no, you know, that we've got to go through this thing. You know, we've got to help each other go through it. So, and I prayed about it. I just prayed, Lord, if you could, this is a, and the Lord showed me, this is a curse. And when you're under a curse, under a spell, under a hypnosis, you're not really aware of what you're doing and how, what you're saying, what you're thinking. You're caught up in a thing. And that's what happened. They got caught up in the spirit. And then I noticed, you know, just cutting to now, you know, this has been several months of this, cutting to now, and suddenly that curse had, the Lord had lifted it. And, you know, it doesn't mean for like, doesn't mean everyone's going to walk out of there, because there's a lot of people that don't believe in Jesus. Or, you know, the Lord wants his people to go. And it's like they suddenly, I'm seeing this across the board more and more, people just sort of drifting away from the Q thing. You know, just kind of, it's like waking up from a dream and you just, you know, you, yeah. You're like, what? And you don't even know what you're doing. You just walk on. You don't need to apologize, right? And you don't need to, go, oh, mea culpa, oh, I really was deceived. You don't have to do anything. I mean, you know, the Lord seems to have just set people free. That doesn't mean that the core New Agers aren't still there, and there's lots of those. And now the latest I've heard from the QAnon camp is they're starting to talk more about the New Age. They're starting to talk about the global awakening. They're starting to talk more about the Age of Light and all that kind of stuff, which I, you know, which is just, you know, that's not our way. The Lord has given us prophecy. The Lord has given us a direction, and he doesn't say, okay, it's all over. He says, we're going to go through a time of a great unveiling and a great awakening, but it's an awakening to see the things that have been hidden. And then there's going to be a great tribulation and things like that, because there has to be a reckoning with all of this. And it's not just going to be an Armageddon. I know the New Agers love the Armageddon bypass idea. Yeah. And what Q was pushing was the Armageddon bypass. Your world is, it's you owe a lot of thanks to Donald Trump and all of us working behind the scenes to make your world a beautiful place, and we're about to emerge out of the darkness.
Right. Now, you know what when people talk about this, what I remember was a story about, I think it was Isaiah, who, when they came away and took all the Israelites and brought them to Babylon, he was spared because he was in prison up to his knees in poop. So that's how God protected him from going away to Babylon. But being in prison in a dungeon isn't exactly a, you know. So, you know, God has a way of, and of course, if you're given gifts or power, if you're given wisdom, there's that risk of getting arrogant So there's this humility thing that comes with it. And so I kind of look at that and say, no, there's no like guarantee of having a great life. Life is like you come here, you learn the lessons, you do your part, you grow, and you leave, and you move on to something else. I mean, it's not like we're going to be downloaded into computers and live forever as robots and have people. That's all ridiculous stuff. All ridiculous. Yeah. I laugh at it. Not to be disrespectful.
But no, it's so ridiculous. I think what's going to happen, what you're going to see happen here in the Q thing, is that the people that God has his hands on are going to just walk away. I think some will learn something. I don't need anyone to learn anything. I don't need anyone to explain anything to me. My prayer is that it just goes poof and evaporates and people just walk away. They just they realize it's just like the psychic phone network or any of those other things. And they just, they just drift away because they're just not interested anymore. And I believe that process has begun. Plus, there's a lot of people really pissed off. You've probably seen them out there. I mean, more and more are calling the QAnon thing on the carpet for all these false statements and lies and everything else. It's like, it's just turning into a real disaster. It's melting down real fast now.
And unlike David Booth or these other people I mentioned, QAnon is anonymous. QAnon could be standing right next to you, and you wouldn't know. So he can just, when it all falls apart, he just walks away.
And I know, but it's enough for me if he just walks away. I don't feel like
that's true.
I'd love to know who he is. I mean, who they are, but I have a feeling they're coming from the other side. Disinfo agents that are trying to get Christians to look like idiots. I think that's pretty much. But then again, there's that new age recruit. I didn't mention this. The whole spirit of it is a new age recruiting, to recruit them away from Jesus into the new age prophecy of the beautiful world.
And to split the Trump support.
And to split the MAGA Trump movement. That's another thing. It's split. It's fragmented that. I mean, that's got to be regathered together. And there's some other things. The Joy Villa thing with her Scientology split a whole bunch of people because she had all this momentum. She was going to the White House and all this stuff. And she was using Scientology. She was going to prayer meetings and anti-abortion, all this, and using this whole platform to sneak in to be an evangelist for Scientology and use it, And wow, I mean, I fell for that one because I just thought, well, who knows what I thought, but
I want to mention something like that. The idea of Scientology, I mean, what I did was I was a Baptist, fundamental Baptist. I taught Bible school and all that, and I had a bunch of stuff happen in my life, divorce, everything fell apart in my life. And I went back to square one, and I said, okay, God, I mean, I is there a God? Yes. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, we'll start from there. I want to know what's real. So I started studying New Age stuff and all this stuff. And I read Dianetics. And I read the book, and I liked the idea of the whole book. I read it all, and I say it's great. Just one thing stood out. In Dianetics, you need a clear person to clear you. Now, in other words, you could pick the Bible up and read it and figure out stuff and have God speak to you without anybody and figure it out. In fact, you could do it in the world without even a Bible, technically, But in Scientology, you got to have that person lead you out of there, and now you're a slave, because they lead you out. You talk about all these things, they record them, and now if you want to pull out, and you're an asset to them or you're a danger to them, now they pull out the tapes of you talking about how you did things when you were younger or whatever, and it became obvious that it was a slave trap, like a lot of organized religion is.
Yeah, and the idea that they were grooming her, Joy Villa, that is, to be the Tom Cruise of politics. Is that what it was? Okay, the Tom Cruise of politics. And I just, but I was fooled by that one.
Well, and,
I went down the road for a while, but as soon as she started, sending people Christmas presents that were Scientology promotions with her on the cover, at that point I had to call it, but here's what she did to the movement. She split it, and now you've got a whole bunch of people following her and other people following other people, and both are hostile to each other, but they're both, say, they're the MAGA movement behind Trump. She went to the CPAC convention, and then she had a split with the. I remember when she and Kaya Jones, both were working on the relief for Hurricane Harvey, and they raised about $3 million to help the people down there. And you know, they were all good friends and lovey-dovey, and then of course they had a big falling out. I watched this soap opera. I don't know why, but it's because. And I'll tell you the reason. We need all hands on deck. We need everyone kind of unified in the spirit, unified behind this idea that we don't want to live in tyranny, that we want to live in freedom. We need everybody. We need Alex Jones. We need everybody, you know, whatever the fighting has been, whatever it is, it needs to stop. And we need to focus on what's coming up, which I think are, you know, elections. And what's at stake at this point is... You know, it's really coming down to freedom or tyranny. It's really coming down to a very stark, you know, the other side is ramped up with all the money in the world, and they're ready to crush and destroy. They've seen the writing on the wall. They don't want this truth movement to go any further. They don't want any of this stuff to go one more step. They are ready to bring the hammer down. They are ready to go to war. They're ready to go to a shooting war. They're ready to nuke the whole place if they can't get their way. They are just absolutely intent on winning and taking back power. And so it's going to take everybody that loves freedom and all of us to make it happen. Alex, I'm absolutely love Alex Jones. I love what InfoWars has done. I'm just, my only issue, of course, was the QAnon thing.
Yeah.
And I'm not the only one. There's right. more than me. Other than that, once we're beyond that, I'm good to go with Alex and the whole bit. So...
He yeah. just got a termination warning from YouTube over the crisis actor, you know, yeah. aspects. That's what I was reading in the tweet here. And Zero Hedge has got the story.
Yeah, no, we knew he got the first strike, and then we knew that.